Certainly, at the moment, yeah. Well, I've lived in Saddleworth for about 25 years now. History about myself. I got into the paranormal side of things, really, was when I was about 13 years old and lived in a place which you'll probably be aware of, Mike, called called Whitefield in Greater Manchester.
Yeah.
Do you know about the background of it?
Not too much.
Okay, I'll tell you a little bit. Basically, cut a long story short, I know we've only got a little bit of time. I saw a young boy next to me bed, was about 13-year-old, and he kind of looked about the same age as me, really. And the way I can describe him is that he had really, really white complexion, and he was lifeless eyes, and basically what happened, he came over to me. Well, I was asleep, I was facing the other side, you know, the wall. And he came over and tapped on my shoulder three times like that.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And then I kind of dismissed it and I was tired and went, you know.
Yeah, like you do sort of thing.
And then it happened again.
Okay.
The third time I turned around and there next to me was this young boy. And he's probably about from where I am to you now, okay? And we looked at each other for 30 seconds. I was looking at him in the eyes for 30 seconds. And when you're speaking to somebody and looking at him in the eyes for 30 seconds, Mike, it's a long time, isn't it?
It certainly is. It certainly is.
So that's what happened. And then guess what I did?
Go on.
I turned around and went back to sleep again.
Casually,
the reason being, because I was half asleep, to be honest with you. But the thing is, you could say, was it a dream? Okay.
Right.
What the difference about that is that my mum was there. Okay. The reason being is because my brothers and my sisters, they had gone to a party, and I was too young to go along. My mum hated the house where we lived at the time because she had constant nightmares all the time. And one of them was that she's seen this coffin lid being put on top of her. And sometimes she swears she was awake. So it's weird, isn't it?
It's a very good grounding, isn't it?
It is a grounding, yeah. So what actually happened is my dad was working away. He was a long-distance lorry driver. And my mum had a dream the night before, and she said to me, "John, is it okay sleeping in our Keith's bed?" Which was like two... They were bunk beds, but they were separated. So mine was against the wall, and my mum was there. The window was here. It was a moonlit night. The curtains were undrawn. The moonbeams were coming in. It was like a perfect horror film, really.
Yeah, definitely.
And the thing is that I woke up the next day, I was going to school, my mum said to me, she was making breakfast, and she said, "John, did you see anything last night?"
So there you knew you wasn't dreaming then.
Well, yeah, you know when people say like a trigger word and then it all floods back, it was kind of like that. And and I said, "Why?" Because it all came flooding back.
Why, what did you see?
And what she saw was green mist around my bed. So I saw the young boy, she saw the mist.
Right, okay.
And that kind of got me interested.
Right.
I was terrified for a week afterwards.
I'm not surprised.
I was only 13-year-old, wasn't I? And then what happened, when I was 18-year-old, I nearly got on my first paranormal investigation. And what actually happened is there's a place in Yorkshire called Blackley Church. I shouldn't really say this, but anyway. Have you? And I remember years ago, there was an interview with these two paranormal investigators. And I was only 18 at the time, which was 20 years ago. So what actually happened, it was years ago. I was about 18 at the time. I was going out with this girlfriend. I'd been going out for 12 years. Not before 18, but 12 years up to, probably a few years before that. And anyway, I listened to it on the radio and I thought, I've got to do this. I didn't work it out. I got some friends and I thought, right, I'm going to Blackley Church. You know, when you're a kid, you haven't got many brain cells, but you don't work it out first here. So I thought, I'm going to Blackley Church. That's what I'm going to do. I didn't think of what I was going to do, how I was going to do it, who I was going to talk to. And I mentioned it to my girlfriend. Now, years ago, the paranormal scene then was non-existent, really, and it was taboo. Kind of thing. She said she got really upset about it, and she says, "If you're gonna go, that's it. We're done. We're finished." And I was in love. I was in love, Mike.
Hooked.
So I said no. Okay. Wow. I didn't go. But the thing is, I could kick myself now because like we only lasted 12 years.
Right.
And I got involved later in life. Basically what happened, I used to write a little magazine. It was a local magazine around Saddleworth. And I seen an advert for... Well, I used to do a lot of research. I was always interested in the paranormal, and I seen some ghost stories in Saddleworth. I seen an advert whilst researching on the internet about going on a ghost hunting event. My sister's birthday was coming up. I took her on a birthday present. My wife knew at the time that once I get involved in things, I kind of get hooked on it and I take over, if you know what I mean. Yeah. And
I know exactly what you mean there.
You're the same.
We're with ourselves.
Yeah.
So.
And a year later, I was working for the company for 5 years. And I'm probably leading into some more of your questions now.
Don't worry about it.
Is that okay? So just carry on. And basically what happened was... Then, after 5 years, I worked for a utilities company on the water side. I was a project controller, and they was offering volunteer servants, and I thought, go for it. And that's what I did. And I set up Mysterious Paranormal Events. And that's what I did. I did that for 5 years, and that was one of my strangest experiences ever. Basically, what happened... is, I won't mention the name of the painting or the gentleman involved out of respect for him, really, to be honest with you. But what actually happened is about 1.5 years into being self-employed into Mysterious Paranormal Events, I received an email from a gentleman saying that he'd got a haunted painting. And he had a video attached. And he swears that he sent it to the wrong guy. But really, he sent it to the right guy because I was interested.
Fate.
As such. Well, these weird things go on. It's so strange. And basically, what actually happened is I looked at the video and I thought, this is either been done on Photoshop or GIMP or something like that, because it was amazing. It was really interesting.
Okay.
And I'm a type of guy, really, who I need to take... I need to keep an open mind. I need to have a go at things. Do you know what I mean? So I said to him, I said, look, I said, I do development workshops and ghost hunting and stuff like that. And I said, what would be excellent if we had this painting? Gives me a chance to look at it. Because he wanted some advice about it, really. And he wanted to find out more about it.
Yeah.
And I said to him, well, why don't you let me look at it? And I'll let... like a lot of guys do psychometry on it, so it's like a workshop. And psychometry, if you don't know what that is. Basically, psychometry is, say if you've got a ring off your grandmother and somebody holds that ring who can and they can sense the past from that ring. So can you imagine a painting, a haunted one? But the only thing you knew is that the painting was painted in the artist's blood.
Okay.
And when he finished it, he committed suicide.
Oh, right.
Okay, so it was a bit of a weird thing, really. And he,
a bit.
And he wanted to know more information. So I worked with it for 3.5 years. The first 2 years, it did things. Not a lot of things, but it did things. The last year and a half, the connection was so strong that it destroyed me, to be honest, when it was taken away.
Felt attached as such, lost a family member or a loved one,
basically. And I've got a lot of guys here tonight who've witnessed what's gone on.
Fantastic.
In the past with the painting. And basically, over that 3.5 years, we got so close that when the painting, I used to talk to it, okay, and the painting, the head of the painting itself would shake for no, and it lift up left leg. For yes.
Ah.
And it got to that, it got as strong as that in the end, you know, it was that close. Yeah, but it wasn't just like a yes and a no. Well, yes, it was a yes and a no, but we had full conversations.
Wow.
He was intelligent, you know. And to the extent, sometimes he'd dance around the room. Like it moved, literally do like a 360 around the room. And you know what? Why I say is intelligent is because he used to, when I got him, it was just a painting. I bought an easel for it, and then it gave him legs. Oh, okay. And it sounds mad, doesn't it? But he was moving about, and he was moving about too much, rocking backwards and forwards and stuff. And I said, David, I said, you need to calm down a bit. Okay. And he did. And I said, instead of rocking it from side to side, why not just slide the easel? And he did, and that's what he did. So he listened to me. He slid the easel round. And I've got it on film.
You've got that on film.
Well, I'm waiting for it, actually, to be honest with you. It has. Yeah, it has. Well, it's with a friend at the moment. Okay. And basically, what actually happened is that it was the last but one time. I actually worked with him. And basically, what you can see on the film, hopefully, I've not seen the film myself yet, and the reason why I didn't film everything is because spirits are not stupid, you know? They know when they're being filmed. He answered to the name of David, but it wasn't his real name, I believe. I found out later. So we always kept him to the name of David because he was happy with that, and he worked with that. And basically, on the film, hopefully, I get it soon. I'll try anyway. The picture was there, okay, side on, and I said, David, can you turn around and face me? And he did. He went like that.
Wow. Absolutely fantastic,
that. And there was a lot of other things as well that went on that particular night. The only thing that, I mean, you can tell it's not a rig up, because the only thing that I had to do, because I know the way it works, is that I just make sure that two people just put the fingertips on the edges of the painting, and that's to give him the energy that he needs. And that's what I'm about. I work with energy. And basically, like I say, what happened is when the painting went back to the owner, and I want to say to the owner, because I'm sure he'll probably watch this, is thank you very much for those 3.5 years. It was an amazing 3.5 years. I kind of went in myself for 7 months. I wasn't interested in anything. I wasn't interested in mysterious paranormal events. And it took me 7 months to get over it. And I've got a manager now, which is Maxine Jane Briggs. And Maxine, she is, isn't she? And she gave me a lot of support, really, to be honest with you. And she said to me, come on, you need to get going again, you know. So
sort of
I did.
The drive which you needed to get back.
Yeah.
On the boat and drive as such.
Yeah. And then was born the Enigma experiment.
That's fantastic.
What actually happened, I kind of got myself together again. We started doing the Enigma experiment. And something strange happened. It was a place called a manor house in London. It was a small event there. And I don't use Ouija boards or spirit boards, if you like, because I don't believe in them. However, I've got one here tonight, but for a different reason. Basically, what happened is I drove all the way to London from Manchester. I took people down there. There was three of us there on the night, two of us, including myself, who drove down. A guy called Bill Smith. He's had lots of experience with the painting too. And the funny thing is that everybody gets attached to David. They have a strong bond, a strong connection. And it was a strange night that night. I was tired. After the event, I went to bed at 3 o'clock in the morning. They decided to bring a Ouija board, or a spirit board if you like, and start to use it when I went to bed whilst I was out the way. Oh. Right? So as soon as they put the finger on the planchette, it spelled out D-A-V-I-D.
David.
Bill Smith got upset. His wife, Cheryl, got upset because they've had all the experiences with him. He told them, excuse me, I still get upset myself these days. He told them that he missed me and he wanted to work with me still, and he wanted to work with me on the experiments.
That is... Wow. So you've been chosen as such.
It's a weird thing. It's a weird thing.
I'd say it's weird. I'd say it's absolutely fantastic and exciting.
It's exciting. We've got a number of experiments tonight. We've got the Eidolon experiment.
Yes.
I'll explain about that. Basically, what the Eidolon experiment is, Well, we'll try it tonight. It's not a sort of thing that picks up on camera, really, but we'll give it a go. It's about transfiguration.
Excellent.
Okay. Yeah. I've got a special table for it and stuff like that. I work a lot with copper. That's what I always have done. Energy at the end of the day, that's what I work with. Do you know the thing about, I'm not poo-poo anybody, how do you work out there? If you're working with a medium and then he says, I can see this, I can see that, you know, you see, you tell him what you can see in the mind, yeah. Okay? I mean, yeah, we all do that. But I like to show people things that happen as well, okay? So it's actual evidence. So I don't use equipment. I have my own stuff, really, the things that I've devised myself to do with energy again. And there's going to be, what else, what other experiments have we got? So we've still got the Eidolon one. We've got the Harbinger experiment, which is basically a crystal ball.
Okay.
And I'll show you what we're going to do with that. Yeah. Hopefully it'll work. It has worked in the past. Okay. And we've got a very, very exciting one, which everyone loves and gets scared to death with, is the Kelpie experiment. Okay. And the Kelpie experiment is about poltergeist activity.
Okay.
Okay. And then we have got the conduction rope experiment. Again, the conduction rope experiment is one that you've got to see yourself.
Yeah, we've heard a little bit and we're anxious to actually see this take place. People told us little bits about when it rises and certain people can follow it as such, as the rope lifts, certain people lift with the rope and other things. So I have heard a little bit about that experiment, to be honest.
Oh, good.
Looking forward to seeing that.
And the old beauty of HMS Trincomalee is it's on water.
Now that's another question I was going to ask you, actually. Because of all this running water underneath the ship, do you think it will actually affect the experiments?
Water's a conductor at the end of the day, isn't it?
So it's going to have a positive impact?
I would say so. David, definitely. David. I think because, when I first met him, I first saw what he could do, I wasn't scared. It was more, I never get scared. I think you get beyond scared, to be honest with you. But I think the most exciting, that's all, I can't say terrifying, because I'm not terrified. The most exciting. And I've got to tell you something. Can I tell you something else as well? Okay. And David is the nicest one. The reason being, I believe you guys have been to 30 East Drive.
Yeah, we've been to a few locations.
Okay. Well, I took David to a place in Pontefract called the Red Lion.
The Pub at the Road. Yes.
And this is one of the nights when me and David had a discussion. We didn't agree with each other on this occasion. And again, it was witnessed by people.
Like friends do.
And I was going to do a two-day vigil on my own in 30 East Drive. But I was going to take David with me to the painting too. The reason being, because can you imagine if you took a haunted presence into a place that's haunted?
Yes.
What would it be like?
Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
it'd be interesting, wouldn't it?
Have you actually done that yet?
Yes.
Chillingham
Castle. I took David to Chillingham, and this was actually before he had an easel, and so he didn't have the means of moving the easel then. And I put the painting on the floor. I propped it up with a chair behind it, because ladies' energies are stronger than men. Okay, it's just a fact.
It's a way of the world.
I put a lady behind him and a lady in front. I got everybody in a circle because that's where we generate energy at the end of the day. A lot of people do that.
Yeah.
Behind the circle, there was a big wooden bench. It was about there. And it was like an old type of oak type of bench.
Okay.
And it was about five foot long. And there's a thing about David being pure evil. Okay. There's always been a thing about that. I think it was the grandmother of the gentleman who owned the painting deemed him as being pure evil.
Okay.
So what happened? I started asking the questions and stuff, and I said, David, I said, would you consider yourself to be pure evil? And he lifted up the bench about that high and banged it down on the floor.
That was in Chillingham?
Yeah. And I said, David, was that a yes? Just bang it once for yes. So he banged it for yes once. And then he started banging once for yes, twice for no. Now, I was a bit confused about that one. Well, yes and no. I'm not. This is another story. I could talk to you all day.
Very knowledgeable guy. It's great.
Yeah. So, basically, what happened then is I said, "Are you?" I can't remember now. I think I said, "Are you connected?" No, I didn't. When I said, "Are you pure evil?" A large dark figure appeared in the circle, and it looked about 6'6". It was huge. And there were 24 people there that night, and they all saw that.